Thank you, Charles, for that introduction. Thank the Academy for inviting me back to be part of this discussion on populism and the future of American politics. I'm going to engage this topic as someone who's trying to finish a book on the question of post-racialism in America, and I'm going to kind of pivot off of that possibility in most of my remarks here this evening. Prejudice and politics have been intertwined in the U.S. throughout my lifetime. Indeed, one could say the same about the full arc of the development and transformation of the United States of America over its nearly 300-year history. Yet, the current moment does feel like a time of deeply acute polarization and unexpectedly, almost indigestible racialized divisions, political identity divisions, ideological divisions. As we near the end of a second term for a popular African-American president and just elected a man as president who many believe ran an openly bigoted campaign, we're confronted with a deep puzzle and question. How on earth did we get here? Tonight I want to argue that the short answer is threefold. First, we have actually just experienced an electoral contest in which a billionaire Republican was able to more effectively cast himself as a champion of the lower, middle, and working classes than his Democratic rival. This was in part made possible, second, by the power of race and racial prejudice in our national politics and political discourse. And frankly, thirdly, by a sort of paralysis that comes about by the two powers of the economic elite and fear of direct appeals to minority voters. I want to begin by recalling for all of you the old term Reagan Democrats, and I want to read you a paragraph from the kind of defining book on the subject by journalists Thomas and Mary Edsel. They were trying to understand, of course, why Republicans kept winning the White House. And they argued in the following diagnosis based on research by pollster Stanley Greenberg. These white Democratic defectors express a profound distaste for blacks, a sentiment that pervades almost everything they think about government and politics. Blacks constitute the explanation for their vulnerability and for almost everything that has gone wrong in their lives. Not being black is what constitutes being middle class. Not living with blacks is what makes a neighborhood a decent place to live. The special status of blacks is perceived by almost all of these individuals as a serious obstacle to their personal advancement. Indeed, discrimination against whites has become a well-assimilated and ready explanation for their status, vulnerability, and failures. We might now replace that word blacks or add to it Mexican immigrants, and we've updated that analysis to 2016. Surely it will not surprise many of you here this evening, but America has neither shed nor, in my estimation, honestly confronted its legacy of racism or, more provocatively, white supremacy. There are deep, ongoing, and highly adaptive conditions of racism at the institutional, cultural, and individual levels that prefigure and play out in our national political discourse. I believe there are strong prohibitions against direct, honest discourse on this matter, and I hope tonight we can provocatively consider some of those. Scholars will surely look back on these times and observe, as philosophers of race Robert Gooding Williams and Charles Mills have written, quote, "It was the most post-racial of times. It was the least post-racial of times." I believe that only when we get beyond the fallacy of color blindness and distorting narrative of post-racialism that we can hope to rise to a point of honest, clear-eyed engagement with how and why politics, prejudice, and polarization so often roil our democratic and collective lives. So, in the brief time I have here, I want to draw attention to kind of three points of contradiction, as I noted a minute ago. One, stemming from the tensions involving the conflict in a way of simultaneous growth of income inequality and of ethno-racial diversity of the population. Two, the tensions that arise from both deepening partisanship on the one hand and what has become the routine racialization of our politics on the other. And thirdly, this paralysis around the power of the economic elite versus fear of appeals to blocks of minority voters. I'll come back to that at the end. For most of the period from 1945 to 1973, as our economy grew, the gap between the most affluent and the least affluent in the U.S. actually shrank. That is, the pie grew and incomes grew for everyone, and those in the middle and lower reaches of the economy actually narrowed the gap a bit between themselves and those higher up. A quite different story has characterized the post-1973 period. particularly the post-1980 era. Since the Great Recession, a disproportionate share of income and wealth has gone upward to the already most well-off segments of the population. A recent report from the Institute for Policy Studies emphasized, quote, income disparities have become so pronounced that America's top 10% now average nearly 9 times as much income as the bottom 90%. Moreover, the top 1% of the population now holds a share of wealth roughly equivalent to that at the time of the onset of the Great Depression. For much of the past 2 decades, the real value of income stagnated for the middle income distribution, and those in the lower quintiles actually saw their purchasing power decline. These economic trends have consequences as more and more Americans experience a sense of serious economic vulnerability and worry that they're not going to be able to pass on better prospects to their children. At the same moment, we've witnessed a sharp rise in the share of the population coming from Asia and Latin America and other parts of the globe. Figures by Brookings Institute senior fellow William Fry show that 64% of the U.S. population could be classified as white in 2010. Between 2010 and 2050, that percentage is expected to steadily decline. Indeed, he suggested probably by 2044, the U.S. will be a majority minority population. We, in fact, have already hit one important benchmark 5 years ago when the majority of new births were children of color in this country. Experimental research shows that when presented with evidence of these demographic trends, many white Americans tend to express a sense of threat from minorities and a greater emotional animosity to them. They also begin to think even more than they already may in zero-sum terms about opportunity and resources. Moreover, there's some experimental work showing that these drawing attention to these demographic trends has direct political effects. Maureen Craig and MacArthur Award winner Jennifer Richardson found that experimentally manipulating awareness of this racial population shift increases white identification with conservative political ideologies and the Republican Party. Enter Donald Trump. It should surprise no one then that this nexus of conditions, sharply rising inequality and increasingly acute sense of economic vulnerability for the lower income and even middle income Americans, in the context of rapid population change in our landscape as we transition from solid majority population to a nation without a clear ethno-racial dominant group, opens the door to a powerfully resonant blend of anti-minority populism. Point two, partisanship and the routine mobilization of race into our body politics. If we were to go back to the presidential contest of 1956 or 1960, you would find that the major party platforms of the Republican and Democratic parties contained largely similar language about issues of civil rights and race. Indeed, both parties at that time actively competed for the black vote to a degree. So, there is no necessary connection between partisanship and party outlook or program and issues of race. Beginning with the 1964 election, however, the two major parties began to sharply diverge on issues of civil rights and race. The Democratic Party clearly ultimately became the party of the effective governmental enforcement of full citizenship rights for African Americans. With it, we witnessed a sea change in partisan alignments. The South went from being largely solidly Democrat-controlled to largely Republican-controlled. Black loyalty to the party of Lincoln, once something you could take for granted, started to weaken significantly during the Franklin Roosevelt and New Deal era, accelerated under President Kennedy, and vanished and was replaced by near complete capture, and I do mean that word capture, by the Democratic Party in subsequent years. An unfortunate effect of these developments is that both major parties, to a degree, depend on racial division for their electoral success. On the one hand, then, in a context in which Republicans are content to completely cede the black vote, Democrats only need do so much to expect black loyalty. After all, where are black voters going to go? So, even under Obama, nothing you could construe as a truly strong minority or black agenda is articulated within the confines of major party politics. On the other hand, especially as the population changes, the Republican Party worries more and more about mobilizing its base and doing what it can to constrain the influence of Democratic voters who are increasingly minority. Not only is race thus increasingly aligned with voting and party ID, but political scientists and political psychologists have shown us that attitudes that we would characterize as racial resentments play an increasingly strong role in defining the meaning of those party attachments. The end result is what legal scholar Ian Haney Lopez calls dog whistle politics. Given improved racial attitudes and success of the civil rights era, however, openly bigoted appeals are fraught with risks of backfiring, at least if they're directed at African Americans. You can apparently do so toward Mexicans for a little while longer. We'll see. But carefully crafted slogans and rhetoric that play on underlying racial resentments and sensitivities has been a routine staple of Republican Party politics. Thus, in Nixon's 68 campaign, we get a Southern strategy and the law and order message. In 1980, we see Reagan launch his campaign for the White House in Philadelphia, Mississippi, where civil rights workers Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney were killed, with a speech calling for the enforcement of states' rights. He also frequently deployed the welfare queen stereotype, or later that of the strapping young buck, using government-provided food stamps and welfare to live better than the rest of you. By 1988, we get Willie Horton. In 2010 and 2012, we hear chants of taking America back. And then in 2016, we return to Reagan's 1980 slogan, Make America Great Again. The rhetoric of the Trump campaign is therefore not some strange aberration, but merely the next iteration in a worrisome pattern and trend. The racially tinged spasm of reaction against passage of the Affordable Care Act, the emergence of the Tea Party, the solidification of Republican intransigence in the House and Senate must be read at least in part through a racial lens. And now, the openly bigoted demonization of those of Hispanic heritage, especially Mexican Americans, when Donald Trump launched his candidacy, would be astounding, except that it is largely of a piece with the long-standing practice of dog whistle politics and tacit racial appeals. Trump merely exploited the vulnerabilities of the moment and upped the ante. Those who underestimated the power of this appeal include 16 major mainstream career Republican politicians, including some with otherwise bankable Republican political credentials and huge financial backing, witness Jeb Bush. Bottom line, we inhabit a troubling moment of the alignment of race and racial policy-related commitments with basic party identities. This is not a healthy circumstance for our democracy. Kind of third and final point here, this paralysis I'm talking about, where the power of an economic elite is somehow wedging and constraining political discourse, and the power of potential minority voters, especially if you really try to mobilize them, is something people are fearful to articulate. So if I had to diagnose the current moment, I'll go back to where I started. Somehow a billionaire who has a gold-plated toilet in his rooftop condominium in Manhattan has a stronger appeal to poorly educated working class whites than a woman running as the head of the Democratic Party with some of the greatest egalitarian credentials in politics you might have. How does that happen? Two parts. One, she won't go after Wall Street, at least not in the way Bernie Sanders did. There's clearly this huge fear of deciding to say, I'm going to represent you guys against these economic elites. And that's part of the elite bias and part of the message that wasn't there. It just wasn't there, especially at the end where the whole campaign is against Trump, not for the rest of you. The other alternative is to say she could have doubled down on the Obama coalition and said, it's clear to me how Obama got reelected in 2012. He got reelected by hyper-black turnout, by more than replacing the 2 million white votes he lost with 2 million plus African American voters. And now here's the thing, it's not getting much coverage, but if we play it right, people will figure it out. The upper Midwest states that Clinton lost, and I'm gonna include North Carolina, Wisconsin, Michigan, Ohio, Pennsylvania, all of it, all of the margin of Trump's victory in each of those states can be accounted for by her lower black percentage vote and lower black turnout. All of it. I want you to think about that. All of it. The National Review issued an article the other day claiming that Trump would have beat Obama. This morning they issued a revision. No, we miscalculated. As it turns out, if Obama had had his 2012 numbers, which he did, and Trump had exactly his 2016 numbers, Obama would have been elected to a third term. Think about that. Now, it is not my point to sound an unremittingly pessimistic note. If there are takeaways here, they're perhaps threefold. First, the current moment is one best read as complex. Changes in our institutions and norms and in the outlooks and attitudes of the mass of Americans have been significant and are not easily overridden or reversed. There are clearly contending political alliances out there. There's no overarching axis of intolerance. If anything, a two-term Obama presidency signals something important about the majoritarian character of the mass public at this point, underlying racial inequality and division notwithstanding, and the real ultimate closeness in the overall vote, and in fact that Hillary won the overall vote. Second, the success of the Trump candidacy to this point of apparent implosion should worry us all the same, because it didn't implode. In this context of economic anxiety, rising inequality, population change, enduring problems of racism and inequality, there's something there's something there that needs to arouse real concern and to be fought against with vigor. Because it's not hard to envision scenarios where this dangerous mix becomes even more divisive and troubling than it already is. Thirdly, as I want to reiterate the point I started on, race has always been an ingredient of American national politics. Its salience, explicitness, and centrality vary from one election cycle to the next, but it's never been an irrelevance. We got to take the blinders off to this post-racial fantasy. The only way to make progress on racial issues is to really face them directly and honestly. Assuming these inequalities, identities, and divisions are not there, or are somehow just willy-nilly naturally healing themselves, is a serious error, as Donald Trump just proved beyond all doubt. Thank you very much.